I think we can get started. Hopefully you can see me from my beautiful home office, which is basically my armchair, and all ready to go. And I'd like to just make sure that the video, the audio are both fine. So why don't you type into the chat box, not that it works because I got confirmation from my Budapest team, but where you're dialing in from. This is traditionally how we usually begin our webinars in this lockdown series. So type in the city or the country where you're from, and we're going to do a little competition. Who's dialing in from the furthest away from our beloved Brussels? Many are from here, Paris, Spain, Alicante, Lithuania, all over Madrid, Bilbao. Buenos dias to all our Spanish friends and those who are in Spain right now and all over Europe. That's excellent. Bom dia to our Portuguese friends and bonjour to our French friends. And the other languages I will not dare to pronounce for lack of my knowledge of those. But everything should be working fine. That's excellent. And I have this video feed just to say hi and that you see me. It's not only my voice and the slides, but I'm a real person, just as much in the lockdown as most of you, if not all of you, all over the world. Especially in Europe, unfortunately, but it's slowly coming to an end. But the good news is our series of free webinars is not yet coming to an end. We have, I think, even two, perhaps even three planned for fairly soon throughout May. So even when hopefully some lockdowns will be over, our series will keep on going. So spread the news to your friends, to your colleagues, to anyone who's interested in EPSO exams, in EU careers, in CVs, in cover letter writing. And the very last one in our series will be on a topic which is very close to my heart, but it's not exactly the EU exams. It's about communication, written communication, and writing emails. So we thought that that sort of skill development will be interesting. So we'll be looking at email writing and effective written communication in the last part. So with that, I'll turn off the camera. So this is me from Brussels, and we're going to be spending the next 1 hour talking about EPSO competencies and values. So let's get into it. And first and foremost, the technical check. Sound should be working fine. Hopefully the internet is not gonna drop. Perhaps my kids are gonna drop into the room. Please be understanding. They are having their school time at this time, but you never know what might happen. And I think many of you are in similar situation with spouses working and kids running around. But we're focusing on our topic, which is EPSO competencies and values. So another technical comment before we get into it is the chat box. So put there any question that comes to your mind throughout the session. I'll do my best to answer it live, but if we don't have enough time or any sort of limitation might prevent me from answering it, we'll come back to it. And we'll send you a written memo with all the questions and answers that have come up in the session. A special thanks to Lenka and Veronica, who are assisting today from Budapest, from their home office, obviously. So they'll be answering some of your technical questions, and they make sure that everything runs as smooth as humanly possible. So with that, a little bit about my background, which you might know, the Ultimate EU Test Book, which I have been publishing since 2005. And I have a major role with EU training and a couple of other ventures dealing with careers, public affairs, communication, and related topics. So with that, let's get into it. And let's take a look at an EPSO notice of competition. Because today's topic, dealing with values, competencies, these are all a little esoteric to most people who have not dealt with assessment centers, for those who may not have taken an EU career exam. So we want to give more details on how the European Personnel Selection Office looks at the ways or the metrics based on which they evaluate you as a potential future EU official. And I see here's the very first question. How many permanent officials in 2019-2020, well, that is, we don't really know exactly how many will be recruited or selected, but we'll see how many are currently there. There are roughly 30,000 permanent EU officials at the European Commission and overall, not permanent, but 30,000 EU officials, around 22,000 permanent, the rest are temporary and contract agents, and there are another 20,000, roughly 20,000 at other EU institutions in employment. But going back to the initial topic, talking about competencies and values, a very interesting, very important distinction between competency and knowledge. Why do we need to talk about this at all? The reason is back in 2009 or until 2010, the way EU institutions selected candidates who would then become EU officials, the way the selection system went, it was entirely based on knowledge-based selection. And that pretty much meant that they had these crazy, crazy quizzes where they asked specific knowledge you had about the EU, its officials, politicians, its policies, its history, anything related to the EU. So essentially stuff you can easily Google these days, look it up on Wikipedia, and answer it in 2 seconds. That is typically what we would consider knowledge. Back then, my test book, as earlier edition, was pretty much that kind of quiz. Those of you who are familiar with the show Who Wants to Be a Millionaire, that's pretty much it, the kind of questions they had, with 4 answer options. My favorite at the time was, how many women commissioners are there in the Barroso Commission, or whichever commission it was at the time? Now, obviously, this is a knowledge-based question, and they realized that this has nothing to do with predicting your performance as a future EU official. So they said, okay, let's transit to a slightly different approach. Let's look at competency. Now, what is competency? Competency is, for instance, give an example of a situation when you had to undergo a lot of stress. Which competency would this refer to? This is an open question. Type that into the chat box. What do you think? Which competency would this relate to? A question like this, an example when you had to undergo a lot of stress. Exactly. Thanks everyone who immediately got this. This is about resilience. So that is something you cannot Google, right? This is something you need to develop in yourself, like a linguistic competence, but similarly, resiliency as a competence. So it's something that you either have or not have in a given moment, but it's obviously something you can develop over time. Whereas when it comes to knowledge, this is the example, what are the 4 freedoms in the acquis communautaire, or the number of women commissioners in the von der Leyen Commission for that matter. So going further, this is a very important distinction because the current EPSO system is almost exclusively relying on competency evaluation. They barely ask you any knowledge. Now there's a slight development or change because they introduced a so-called motivational interview in the assessment center. So that motivational interview has some resemblance to a knowledge-based test. But then again, it mostly looks at your motivation to work for the European institutions and the European Union. So that is not entirely a knowledge-based approach. But when they ask you about EU decision-making or a couple of what were the major treaties that the EU was built upon, that is a knowledge-based question. But it's, again, a very small proportion of the overall testing approach. It's essentially competency-driven. Now, what are these EPSO competencies? These are fairly well known. It's published on the EPSO website. It's pretty broad public knowledge. So it's analyzing problem-solving, communication, delivering quality and results, prioritizing and organizing, learning and development, resilience, working with others, and leadership. Oops. There we go. It was a little lag. So leadership. Leadership is only for administrators. And we'll talk about that a little later, why it's not the same as management experience, why it's not the same as being the boss of a number of people, but leadership is different from that sort of organizational role. Very important to emphasize. So everything that I'm covering here is essentially related to the second major part of the selection process, which is the assessment center. So the pre-selection tests, those of you who are familiar with the system, we covered it quite extensively in previous webinars. Feel free to look those up. The recording is freely available. Typically, there is the first big chunk of exams in all EPSO processes. It's pre-selection tests, typically with abstract, verbal, and numerical reasoning tests. The second major set of exams is related to the assessment center. That is what's happening or takes place typically in Brussels, exceptionally in Luxembourg. And it's in the assessment center where they truly, genuinely test the competencies that we are covering now. On the other hand, it's interesting to get an understanding, even if you are not immediately preparing for the assessment center, because it gives you a deeper look into the way the European Union's institutions are looking for their new staff. It gives you an understanding of the kind of things, the kind of competencies you can start developing in you. And another very important point, I really like to emphasize that. Completely independent of the EPSO tests and EPSO exams, the concept of competencies, especially these eight competencies, is really helpful for your career. No matter what career you're aiming to pursue, and certainly you're very interested in EU jobs and the specific exams you need to pass to get those jobs, you want to optimize your performance based on these metrics. But even regardless of that, it's a good investment in your own attractiveness as a candidate, as a job candidate, to develop these competencies. Because this is something that greatly contributes to your personal development. And if you are a better communicator, if you are more conscious, more aware of how you can deliver better quality and results in your work, if you are more resilient, if you are working with others in a more efficient, more effective way, all of this makes you a far better candidate for any job whatsoever. Another point, and I'm sort of pitching the idea why it's worth looking at these things, these soft skills, as they're often referred to, is that many other organizations, not just the EU institutions, but United Nations, especially in English-speaking countries, so UK, US, they tend to use this sort of recruitment system, which is based on assessment centers. So developing these skills and understanding what competencies and generally even values, something we'll talk about, why that matters so much, it will make your job prospects much better, because the hiring system you might face, even if it's not the EU, you will be familiar with this, you can perform better, and in the long run, you'll just have a more successful career. So this is pretty cool. It's really worth investing some time and energy into developing it, if for nothing else, for self-help and personal growth. So now that I hopefully completely sold the idea that it's worth listening to, let's look at these eight competencies, and more specifically in the context of EPSO, to see how these are measured. So through the competency tests, these are basically measured in the assessment center, as we said before. And there are very specific exams through which you need to demonstrate the degree to which you have these competencies. One of them is a case study. Another one is a group exercise. Another one is the so-called CBI, or competency-based interview, or sometimes referred to as a structured interview. And then, more often than not, there is also an oral presentation. So this is the very concrete way through which you can demonstrate the degree to which you have or not have given competency. Let's look at this in more detail. If you look at a notice of competition in the EPSO context, this is the grid that you would find in every single notice of competition. Now, this is not the same for every exam. Every exam might have a different grid, But typically, they would have the 8 competencies on the left side and different tests laid out the way you see it here, with different X at different spots, where EPSIL would indicate in the notice of competition which competency is tested through which exam. So for instance, in our example here, you can look at the analyzing and problem solving, which is tested through the situational judgment test, E-tray exercise, and the oral presentation for this particular exam. Now, as far as we know, situational judgment test and E-tray will be phased out, perhaps for all new exams. We need to see that. So that will probably not be a method through which they evaluate a given competency. On the other hand, resilience will probably be tested through the competency-based interview and oral presentation. For other exams where you may not have an oral presentation as part of the assessment center, they could say competency-based interview and group exercise will be testing the resilience. So all of this might vary, but there's a principle that there are always two exams through which they measure a given competency. And that's a good practice because you might completely mess up your competency-based interview and they might get the impression, and in parentheses, I mean, they refers to the selection board, which is in charge of your competition, parentheses closed. On the other hand, you could do great group exercise. And in the group exercise, you demonstrate a fantastic resilience. So they need to have a more nuanced picture of a given competency because it's not that easy to evaluate it. Think about it. You observe a group of people discussing a file in the context of an exam. Let's say you're the assessor. And there you get a certain impression about the person you are observing, but the person might behave quite differently when they are by themselves. So you need to have a more nuanced understanding of their competency, which may vary from one situation to another based on group dynamics, based on a multitude of factors. So that is one. And this is another way of presenting this with the notice of competition. Again, very clear outlining which competency is measured through which test type. This is public information for every exam. It's always in the notice of competition. And you can know, you're aware of this upfront. So this is pretty good because you know what to plan, how to prepare for it. And what does this matrix reveal? Well, what the assessors will be assessing per test. This is clear information. And which competencies to focus on. So you will know in advance when you are prepared for the assessment center which specific competency you need to optimize for and make sure that you have the highest score based on the grid, which you will be aware of. So it's very important to know which competency actually means. You might have some gut feeling or some basic understanding of what resiliency is, but you may not be fully aware of what it is in the context of that specific exercise and what it means for EPSIL more specifically. This is very typical, for instance, for leadership. I talked about it very briefly, but we'll come back to it. There are so many interpretations of what leadership is, but it's yet again different for what it means in the context of your assessment center. You can judge the desirable behavior. You can be the best self and perform and showcase your best abilities in that context because your aim is to get the highest scores possible in a given test. So with that, let's look at some examples. So competency-based interview preparation. So for instance, gather your best examples for learning and development, resilience, and leadership. In the context of the assessment center, you would be asked, or you will be subjected to a competency-based interview. As you might know, this is a kind of interview where they ask you situational questions. So they would say, can you give me an example when you had to learn something new and you succeeded? So you would know that this is the competency that they want to understand. This is the competency they are looking to evaluate. so you can prepare for it with the right examples and the right ideas. Now, one reason why candidates do pretty poorly in this competency test is that they may not have a full grasp of what a given competency actually means. So EBSCO seeks really candidates with the right competencies that we talked about and the right values and those who understand the culture of the EU institutions. And the closer you match with the desirable behavior, so basically what the assessors are looking for, that will optimize your competency scores and it will have a better impact on your scores and higher chances to get on the reserve list. So let me pause here for a second before I go further, because I see that there are a couple of questions, and let me try to address it quickly. So the first one, was related to the issue I briefly discussed, which is how many permanent officials work in the EU. Where can you find that? I think the DGHR, Human Resources, DGHR, should have an annual report. And I believe that number should be there somewhere. So Google around, try to look for that, perhaps the most recent one from 2019, and you should be able to find it. Question number two, is knowledge, especially in EU matters, tested in any phase of the selection procedure, or is it anyway involved in any stage? Very happy you asked this question, because I briefly mentioned it in my intro, but there's a lot of confusion around it. To the dismay of a lot of, traditional or more classic EU civil servants, there's barely any test of the new staff's EU knowledge. What does it mean? There's very little knowledge-based element in the selection process, with the exception of the motivational interview, and a little bit, or rather indirectly, they would want you to know the EU so you can process the case study faster. You can process the information in the group exercise or the oral presentation files faster. But none of those exercises or exams are actually knowledge-based in and by themselves. So what does it mean? You might get a file in the group exercise where you need to analyze something on self-driving cars and what the EU's policy approach is on self-driving cars. But they will not ask you any information that you're expected to have based on your preparation, professional background, or reading a lot of books. This, you're only expected to use those files in the background. So there's no direct request for you to know basically anything about the EU, but it's very helpful because you're not going to mix up the Council of Europe and the Council of the EU. You're not going to mix up the Committee of the Regions and the Committee of the European Parliament. So you certainly need to have some basic understanding of how the EU works and the political side of things, but this is not something you will be directly tested on. So I hope this answers the question that the knowledge in and by itself is not required, but you need to have a certain basic understanding, at least to avoid saying something really stupid, which might harm your scores indirectly. On the other hand, even the case study is not fully about your knowledge. So even the case study is based on the background documents, and you can come up with an answer, a pretty good answer, based on those files and with a lot of common sense, without having an in-depth understanding of the EU. The place where EU knowledge might play a much bigger role is actually the very final stage, once you're on the reserve list, at the job interview. So there they might ask you more specific things because they want to make sure that from the limited number of candidates who are on the reserve list, they pick someone who has a more intimate knowledge of the institutions and the system. Other question, and field-related interview. Now, field-related interview, for those of you who may not know, that is an interview for specialists. So those who have specialty competition law or food safety experts or any other that EPSO is running competition on. And there, the knowledge in that specific field becomes important, but that is not EU knowledge per se. Now, the good news is, and I wasn't following the chat directly, but my colleagues may have put it, but if not, I'll ask them to place the link where you can find e-courses completely free of charge on our website on the EU institutions and a couple of basic stuff, with the caveat that we haven't updated this for many years, and these are not fully up to date, but these presentations and learning courses give you a fairly good and quick understanding of how the EU operates. So this is something you can look at and get that basic understanding. And the European Parliament has pretty good resources as well about various EU policies, decision-making, and institutions. Let me take one more question and then we go on. So professional experience overcomes academic qualifications. I'm not sure where this idea comes from. So professional experience and academic qualifications, there is always a minimum level. So there's always, you need to have a certain degree for a given job. It might be a bachelor, it might be a specific degree, it might be perhaps even a PhD, depending on which exam we're talking about. And professional experience is often not necessary for AD5, so Administrator 5, which is the entry level. There is no professional experience required. It might be relevant at the point of recruitment. So once you've done the selection process and the recruitment happens, other than that, it's not required and it's not a formal requirement. Good, let me go on. And I see there are a couple more questions, but we'll come back to that in due course. So let's go back to the whole idea of how EPSO assessors rank your capabilities per competency. What is the scoring system? It's very interesting. Now think about it, that you are an assessor and you need to score someone on their ability to work with others or put a score on their communication skills. How are you going to do that? You say, well, this person, well, they speak pretty good, pretty fluently. They speak fairly confidently and clearly and logically, and there is a structure to it. Great, let's give them a full score. Luckily, this is not how it works. There is a system to it, which is based on so-called indicators, positive, negative indicators. So indicators are very concrete things that the assessors need to look out for to rank the performance and be able to give a certain score. So each competency has its own set of positive and negative indicators. These are not public, but there is a lot of best practice around it. So we've spoken with a few experts and we have our occupational psychologist expert, and he's created a system which is really mapped and mirrored onto EPSO's system. And this helps understand how this system works in practice. So for instance, when you look at analyzing and problem solving, what would be a positive indicator? Well, a person copes well with complexity, identifies the root causes of certain issues and doesn't stop at superficial results, makes practical, workable suggestions. This is pretty easy to observe if the candidate is giving an oral presentation. You as an assessor ask them a couple of questions and they say, well, I suggest you do this, or I think this would be a good course of action to find a solution to this problem. That is a practical, workable suggestion, immediately indicating this person has a high ability or solid ability to analyze problems and solve them. Another one, communication. So obviously it's essential to have clear communication skills. Positive indicator would be speaking clearly and fluently, not going into all direction in the world, like a little river, which is totally unregulated. It's clear, following a path, aiming at a direction. Uses the correct balance of detail and conciseness, identify, convey key points of an argument. Very similarly, delivering quality and results, what would be the indicators? Quality standards, understand, or seeks to continue to exceed expectations. How can you prove that? So let's take the example of the competency-based interview. You as a candidate, you get a question. Can you give me an example when you had to finish a project and you lacked some knowledge on how to actually approach it, how to start working on it. What did you do? And you can then provide a detailed answer on your approach to that problem and say, well, I asked a couple of experts what they thought about it. I convened a consultation of the leading voices in a given sector and got their input. So I drafted a memo and then I had it reviewed by four independent people who didn't know about each other to get a broader overview. And in the end, I provided the report, which my boss was very pleased with, and the director general used it for his meeting with a government minister. So this would be a great way to show, to demonstrate how you approached a problem and you sought to exceed expectations from your superior. So there are very concrete ways where you can demonstrate these traits, these indicators, and you can really reinforce the message that you have those characteristics. That's why when it comes to all these competencies, the way you present yourself, the way you present an example in the interview, the way you behave and act in a group exercise, the way you interact with others in the context of the assessment center becomes really important, because everything, the way you act, the way you speak, the stuff you say, the stuff you write, all of this is an indicator. All of this relates to a competency, and it can help or hurt you depending on which one we're talking about. Learning and development, a very similar one, taking on board new information, that you're willing to take steps to improve your knowledge, that you are curious and you can demonstrate this curiosity. You cannot just go in and say, you know what, I'm pretty curious. I'm really interested in learning new stuff. I'm watching YouTube all day. Well, excellent, good for you. But the thing is, what demonstrates you're truly curious? Did you take an e-course? Did you get a certificate in the end? Did you try to write some article on that topic or demonstrate your knowledge? Is there a way we can actually verify the claim that you are interested in learning? So all of these are very important aspects where you don't just declare something out of the blue and hope others will believe it. It's truly demonstrating it. And you don't necessarily need to show certificates and testimonials and stuff like that. But through a solid example, you can prove your point to say, well, I was very interested in learning Arabic, and I didn't know a single word. I set myself a goal to have a basic conversation with the guy around the corner in his restaurant, because we're good pals there. And after 4 months, I managed to talk about the weather and some basic stuff with him. So you see, you demonstrate with something tangible, very concrete, your desire to learn, and you achieved a certain goal. So with that, prioritizing, organizing, we're almost done here with all the competencies. What does that mean? Setting realistic deadlines, managing your workload efficiently, demonstrating it through examples. Adapt effortlessly to changes in plans. It's a little bit close to resilience, but again, this is about your ability to organize your work. And then what's left? Resilience. There we go. Resilience. And I think we'll have the leadership one. Resilience is a very important one. I think now in times of lockdown, you can give great examples of how you became resilient, for lack of another or a better option, with the workload and frustration and difficult times and the minimal social life, and perhaps kids in your household, and all the challenges that this situation poses. So remaining calm under pressure, reacting positively to change, responding confidently to criticism. Certainly, there are ways where you can demonstrate this in a live setting. So in a group exercise, resilience can be fairly easily observed. How you react to another group member's criticism, what you do when your ideas are not taken on board. But when it comes to the interview, you need to come up with examples to show your resilience. Resilience may also be tested in the oral presentation. So you're standing there and the selection board members, the assessors, will ask you tough questions about a file that you barely had time to read. What are you going to do? So that is difficult. Your body language will show whether you are resilient. Your tone of voice will show your resilience. Let me give a pretty concrete example for that. When you are asked a difficult question and you may not know the answer, there are different ways you can react to it. You can fold your arms, look down, turn your head, and your voice might sound like, I'm not sure. I think you gather from all of these little cues and ideas that I sound really, really intimidated, very uncertain. On the other hand, if they ask you a difficult question, you keep an open posture, you look them in the eye and say, I'm not sure I remember this particular data or piece of information, but I'll make sure to get back to you after the meeting. This is a pretty typical answer, and they've probably heard it a million times. Another very good way to answer a difficult question is to tell them how you would find out the answer. So you don't know the answer, but you would tell them how you're going to find out the answer. What you could say is, I'm not sure I recall this particular piece of information, but the way I would approach the problem or the way I would try to find out the answer is to ask EFSA, the European Food Safety Authority, for their analysis on this particular issue and then cross-check it with a few other data points from different international authorities and then do an analysis and send a memo. You see, I had no idea about the answer, but I demonstrated resiliency because I could show the way I would approach a problem. So again, as a side note, you see that this sort of technique, this is not EPSO specific. Certainly, it's about a competency that EPSO tries to evaluate. It's about resilience. But understanding this concept and having certain techniques in mind will help you in any job interview. It will help you in a professional settings. It will help you if you give a presentation to an audience and you have no clue about the answer. So you see that everything that you learn about the competency development, certainly we're framing it now in the context of EPSO, but it goes way beyond that. So let's go further. Looking at working with others, that's right, we haven't covered it yet. It's about including others in the decision making. It's about actively listening to others. Oh, you know, we probably know, but you've been victim of it, perhaps even a perpetrator, how difficult it is to listen to others. Listening is not just shutting up and nodding. It's truly genuinely trying to understand the other person's perspective. This is very easy for an assessor to observe in a group exercise where one person might be too invested in making their voice heard, and they just want to listen to the extent that they can actually go on and provide their own perspective. Whereas those who are really good at working with others and they have good listening skills, they will repeat, reframe in their own words what the other said and say, did I get it correctly that what you're trying to say is? And then you say it in your own words. That's a pretty good line, actually. Did I understand correctly that your idea is, and then you finish the sentence. This is a good sentence. This is very helpful in a group exercise setting. And again, not just in an EPSO group exercise, but in any other context as well. And working cooperatively across the organization with others in a competency-based interview, you can give lots of good examples of how you worked with people in other units or in other areas. And let's look at the final one, which is leadership. As I said, it's only for administrator level. For assistants and secretaries, this is not a competency that they measure. Leadership is interesting because it's not management. This is not about you having a few people report to you or working with people in a hierarchic manner. where you would be the boss of another person. This is really about motivating others, getting other people's buy-in. Hopefully that will come back. Let's wait for a second. Silence is back. It's back. It's back. Excellent. I can see that sound is back. Thank you very much for your patience. I think my internet wanted to take a little break, but sound is back and we're all happy. Very good. So we'll go back to the leadership, but I don't know for until which point you heard. So let me just repeat that part because anyways, pretty important. So even if you heard some of it, then hopefully the point will be remembered better. So what is leadership and what it's not? It's not a position power. It's not about you having some sort of hierarchy above the others or others formally working for you. It's really about inspiring others to follow you voluntarily. And that's a key word, voluntarily. Where you would want to demonstrate through your own behavior, through your own actions, through being an ethical and person with integrity, that others would say, oh, that's the kind of stuff I want to follow. And certainly it's difficult to demonstrate this in a group exercise, but you can say, well, I listen to what you want to say and I try to integrate your perspective into my approach. I want to make sure that you will be convinced, you'll be persuaded by what I tell you, and you're not going to follow what I tell you because I'm your boss, or because I threaten you, or because any other way. As a completely side note, by the way, there's a book which is an incredible book, and I highly, highly, highly recommend to everyone interested in this topic. It's by a guy named Marshall Rosenberg, but the book's title is What Matters. You'll find him and the book elsewhere. It's called Nonviolent Communication. And nonviolent communication, ultimately, it's about leadership. Because the way you talk to another person is with a lot of respect, even if you fundamentally disagree with what they say, but they will feel that you respect them enough, so they might as well change their mind. So this is pretty good. Nonviolent communication, deep democracy. Okay, interesting comment. So let's go back to the leadership part. And what it means, it's really about integrity and demonstrating and persuading the other through the best possible ways. This can be shown really in a group exercise fairly well of how you communicate and interact with others. You can give examples in your competency-based interview answers as well. There are many ways to demonstrate leadership, but it's certainly not about, I was managing four people. It's not about, I was the boss of three people. That's not leadership. That's more management. Fine. So now that we covered all these nice competencies, how are they scored? Well, they are scored on a beautiful spider web like the one you see here. This is from an actual candidate, obviously anonymized. And they show here the grid of how good this person was on each of these competencies. You can see prioritizing, organizing, relatively low, analysis and problem solving, relatively low, delivering quality and results, pretty high, working with others, pretty high. So this gives a good overview. The idea is that at the end of the assessment center, whether you passed or not, you get a spider web like this, a chart like this, and it helps your improvement, helps your reflection on how, where you scored and where you could improve. So let me take here 2 minutes of pause and answer a couple of questions that have come in since before we go on and talk about values. So here's one. Can resilience also be described as adaptability? To some degree, yes. I think adaptability is part of resilience. Adaptability is is an important element of being resilient because it requires flexibility. But resilience, especially in the EBSCO context, often tends to be more situational, more nuanced, and not as a broad character trait that I am generally adaptable and flexible, but to say, well, here was a pretty unexpected situation, and how did I maintain my sanity, my calmness, my awareness? So resilience tends to focus on that particular moment or situation, whereas adaptability, I think, could be part of a situation for sure. But now in the context of coronavirus, well, adaptability seems to be how you adapted in the course of days and weeks to this strange new situation. Whereas resilience would be, okay, all of a sudden my kids' school closed and I had to stay home with them. And what did I do from one day to another? How did I not lose my mind and make sure that I found a good, flexible solution? Other question, does prioritizing and organizing have to do with adapting plans according to circumstances? To some degree, yes. So the prioritizing organizing is more about project management. So more about work than you personally. So you being able to deliver a good result by establishing your right priorities and organizing your workload. So indeed, if let's say you are waiting for an important package, and your plane was, or the package delivery was canceled, how do you find a workaround solution, an alternative solution? Okay, what else? I was in two competitions, AST, SC1 and AST3. I had the same approach on both, which I probably said something that the person asking this question is referring to. I had the same approach. The first one, I scored really high, and another one, had half of the score with the same answers. Is there a specific reason for that? Well, without knowing more about the context, it might depend really on the kind of exam you have. So perhaps for what the expectation is for a given competency for secretaries might be different from what the expectation is for assistants. So whereas for secretaries, it might be more important that you follow procedures, that you make sure that the hierarchy, so your superiors, sign off on a certain document. Whereas for assistants, they would value more independency and independent work. So since the roles are slightly different, the importance or the approach of a given competency might as well be different. Okay, let's go and talk a little about values. It's pretty important to talk about values in this context, and you'll soon understand why. Now, values, what are values? Shared beliefs or ideas about a desirable or undesirable outcome. This is important on a bit of a macro level. When it comes to EU jobs, they are framed, presented in the context of values, because ultimately, what kind of future staff would EU institutions want? They want people with certain integrity, commitment to the European idea. These are all values. So values are a little broader, but they do sort of trickle down to even operational decisions. Values are really have a major influence on your behavior and attitude, even on a personal level. But then it all ties into the business or the organization's culture. And often they're a bit less generic than competency, so are a little more overarching. The reason why we found it important to talk about values is sometimes in some situations when you're a little lost or confused or don't know what is the right approach, the right answer, you probably want to consider which values should guide your decision. So the EU institutions, they are public administration. So hierarchy is an important value, and respecting the hierarchy is an important value. Perhaps it's a bit far-fetched to compare it to an army, but definitely there is a chain of command where the big, broad political decisions would be taken on higher levels of the hierarchy, which others in the civil service need to follow. And if you are a truly independent soul who says, I'm a free spirit, nobody should tell me what to do, well, perhaps EU institutions are not the best employer for you in that case. But something to bear in mind. Loyalty to the institutions, another important aspect, that if you are working for the European Commission, you're not representing the European Parliament. But if you take a step back and you look at EU institutions in general, say, well, then loyalty to the European interest or the European Union, and not looking at the interest of any third country. So loyalty, another important value. Third one is authority. So having the position of an authority towards private companies, towards NGOs, towards other governments, making sure that the positions you represent, it's coming from the European Union's institutional political authority. Following the rules and procedures, this is sacrosanct. Not following it is the ultimate blasphemy you can ever do in an institution. So rules and procedures are really, really important to be followed. Equal opportunity, making sure the non-discrimination is an important value. Quality of the service, making sure that you always act professionally and up to the standards that European citizens might expect. Public image, another important one, where institutions are anyway struggling with a legitimacy crisis. So public image becomes an even more important aspect. And the work atmosphere, to preserving a collegial, supportive work atmosphere. So you see, these are somewhat broad, but still important guiding principles. Now, some of these are written in the staff regulations. Some of these are in a document called Code of Good Administrative Practice. This is something you can find on the Commission's website. And others are based on experience, just simply distilling these as important values in the institutions. And actually, you can see here that the name of the document I just mentioned, Code of Good Administrative Behavior, you can just Google it, put EU after it, and you will find it. Now, there are also a couple of other principles, which is another guiding light on how EU officials are expected to act, and also helps you in your behavior, all the things that you say and the examples you come up with, even in the context of EPSO exams. So commitment to the EU and its citizens, integrity, a very important part, objectivity, another important part, respect for others, all EU citizens and organizations, and transparency are also, it's increasingly important that you're accountable for the position that you take as an EU official. So I think that these ideas would help you understand the kind of behaviors, the kind of approach that you are expected to demonstrate. And the way you can excel in each of these areas, well, understanding the competencies and the values will get you into the right mindset. And using both of all of this is something that EPSO assessors will be looking at in the course of the competitions where you are a candidate. Demonstrating these through your examples, through your behavior, through the stuff you say during the exams, through the assessment tasks, will get you a higher score. So very practically, these are shown through the exams and the exercises that we talked about. So the case study, the master, so the assessment center part, and we're happy to help you with all of this. So we have resources on the site, you have ebooks, you have lots of free materials, articles, but of course, if you wanna go deeper, then you can do group exercise simulation, you can hire a coach, you can look at webinars. We are happy to help you in each and every step of this way. So with that, we have a couple more minutes for questions. And by the way, make sure you join the various Facebook groups where you can discuss these concepts and the actual preparation tactics with others. And make sure that you email us if you have specific questions. And to me or to any member of our team, they will be more than happy to answer it, obviously free of charge. So reach out to us and we can guide you further. So with that, let's look at a couple of questions, but stay tuned and make sure to dial in also next week. We are slowly transiting to more, so a different aspect of the job search process. We'll be looking at CVs and cover letters and motivational letters and doing a couple of reviews and very, very actionable tips on how you can improve your chances of getting hired. And as I said, we'll also look at emails at one point, but there are two or three more webinar sessions coming up. But let me look at a couple of questions, so stay tuned. One is, in competency-based interview, do they evaluate every competency at the same time, so simultaneously, or a competency per question? It's a one competency per question. So they would say, well, we're going to look at learning and development. And then they ask you maybe two, three, four, five specific questions around that competency. So they're not going in a random order. You will always know which one is being evaluated. Would giving concrete examples when you exercise a particular competency in your private life, or is it not something you should do? Well, we always say that try to focus on professional examples. Try to look for examples that are coming from your work background or internships or summer job, any other. In some cases, private examples might work if they are as close as possible to a work situation. So for instance, if you organized a surprise birthday party to your brother and you had to coordinate with 50 people without revealing the secret, well, that's sort of a project management for a private cause, but still you can demonstrate certain capabilities, certain competencies through that. So that's where I would draw the line. But something that is truly, truly private, I probably would try to refrain from it. What else? Would giving concrete example, I asked, is it possible to find any deeper explanation of EU values and where? And how can we show understanding and involvement in the EU values during the selection process? Let me go back for a second to the EU values, if I can quickly find it. So for instance, when it comes to these values or principles, you can demonstrate, say, integrity. You say, well, I was a project evaluator and I had to look at five different projects, and one of them was actually from my hometown. So I immediately called a conflict of interest, even though I didn't know the company. The very fact that they were coming from my country or my hometown, I decided to step back and pass on the evaluation to someone else. So this is a very concrete example that you value integrity, making sure that there's no conflict of interest. So this is a pretty far fetched or high flyer principle of integrity, but you narrow it down for a very concrete example of what you did. So thinking deeply about these principles and values will help you come up with concrete examples. All right, what else? Maybe one more question. Yes, how can I show leadership capabilities in the structured interview even when I've never had a responsibility or role in job duties? I like this question a lot because many candidates might be wondering, yeah, how can I show leadership if I've never had that sort of formal leading role or maybe not even a job? Well, you can say, when I was at university, I was in charge of the college newspaper, and we were a group of friends doing a monthly publication. The way I approached it, the way I coordinated with my team, the way I persuaded them to go out and find stories and meet the deadline and put it all together was so and so. So you can demonstrate that this is leadership without any formal work experience or any other. You can even say, I initiated something. So leadership is often about initiating something which is not part of your job description. So if you say, I in my community, where I live, I realized that there were a lot of homeless people. So I initiated a fundraising to give them some food and some shelter and just raise some money for them So I put out posters and Facebook posts and gathered a couple of people, and we managed to raise 500 euros. So you see, this is also leadership. So you can demonstrate that through taking initiative and others following you voluntarily. So I understand there are a couple of other questions. I'll be happy to come back to those in written format, but in respect of everyone's time and probably my kids being very itchy out there because I promised them we'll finish on time after 1 hour, we'll stop right here. But as I said, if you have other questions or any comments, please send them my way or to the team. We'll be more than happy to follow up. And thank you so much for your attention and your time and staying all the way. Much appreciated. Hope you found it interesting and valuable. Thanks very much for your time and stay safe. Hopefully confinement will be over. I'm probably closing each of my webinars with this sentence, but now it's really slowly, slowly coming to an end. And tell others about the webinar series and hope to hear from you very soon. Take good care and thanks for your time.